Praise the Lord, everybody. Welcome to TNT, Tuesday Night Teaching from Solid Rock Church, 118 Rockledge Road, Wilmington, North Carolina. So we hope that you'll come on in the room. We want to see some smiling faces in this room. Yes, we do. All right, Solid Rock, where are you? I can't wait but just so long before I have to move on. Y'all know how I roll. So we're grateful for the blessings of the Lord always. And grateful for those of you that choose to even join us as we, hello Ethel, good to see you. For those of you that choose to join us, amen, we're glad that you're here. Deborah Badilla's on here, all right. Susan Johnson, Phoebe is in the room, amen. Thank you, Sister Phoebe, Minister Phillips, Opie, amen. We're just so thankful for all of you. And if you could like it and share it, that would be awesome. Ralph, all right, I know you'd be on here sooner or later. So, you know, there's so many things going on round about us tonight, and there's so many concerns in our government, in our world, and we just need the Lord to intervene on our behalf. So let's just pray before we even get started. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for the privilege we have to call on your wonderful name. God, we thank you tonight that you said that we could call and you would answer. And Lord, there's so many people that have great needs tonight. Many people are dealing still with COVID. Many folks are still dealing with sickness, oh God, of all different kinds. But God, we thank you tonight that you are a deliverer. You're a healer, a burden bearer. You're a way maker. And we realize tonight there's nothing too hard for you to do. Father God, we ask you to send your spirit out across these airways tonight. And God, that you would touch men and women and boys and girls and draw them into your kingdom. Heal, oh God, save, deliver, set free. Oh God, we thank you for the privilege we have to come into homes. And God, we thank you, Lord, that you would anoint us tonight to sing, anoint us tonight to play, anoint us tonight to talk about your word. Oh God, and heal your people. Their minds are so confused with so many things. And God, we need clarity of understanding. Touch pastors across the land that are struggling and don't know what to do and how to do. Encourage their hearts tonight. We thank you that you're on the throne and you see where we at. And you made us a promise. You would always cause us a triumph. And we give you glory for it in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Well, we see Jimmy Whitehurst has finally joined the ranks. Amen. Sing along with us if you know these songs, will you?
While traveling through this world of sorrow,
I bless you, Lord.
to everybody else that's been joining us. Amen. We saw Paula jump on there and Sonny and Jacqueline here, and there's a few others coming on in the room. We're glad to have you on tonight. Amen. Don't you want to know more about the Lord? Hallelujah. There's nothing better to know about. Amen. Bobby, good to see you. Amen. We're going to sing the old song, Come and Dine. And, you know, really, it'd be great if I could really hear y'all singing. So, won't y'all just really belt it out really good? Hey, Glenda. Amen. Oh, Glenda Lewis is on here. Hey, y'all. We love you.
Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed.
Armstrong and all the others that keep popping up. Hey, Joey, glad to see you, son. Appreciate you joining us every time. So, you know, these songs are not new, but they still have something to say. And if you'll sing along and listen, I believe it'll touch your heart tonight. Amen.
What a fellowship, what a
Jesus. Lord, it's good to see you. All the rest of you that have joined, we're glad you're in the room tonight. And we're thankful that the Lord is always faithful to grace us with all of you wonderful people that join us every week. You're just a wonderful support to us. And we thank you for you're taking your time. Hey, Kathleen, I wondered where you were. Amen. Good to see you tonight. And Tanya Stevens and David from Kentucky, we're glad you're in the room as well. Amen. So, you know, we're just singing old stuff, so just sing along. It'll make you feel better.
Some folks are known by their name. Some I just know.
And to come along and do the will of the Father, it's just wonderful to know that He didn't leave us where we were. He loved us way too much to leave us there. And I'm thankful tonight. I saw Paula was on here and a few others, and Gail Johnson. Wow, it's so nice to see you this evening.
Give up and let Jesus take over.
Make a way for you.
Hallelujah. He's a wonderful Savior. Amen. We have quite a few folks that ask for different things at different times, and so we're going to, we're singing quite a few songs, but it'll be all right.
Touching Jesus. Yes.
you call on his name. So tonight we have a request to sing. That ain't the name of that song. I know, but that's a, we're going to sing a special request. So he texts us and let us know. But it's all right. We know what we're singing. We might not can tell you the title of it, but we know what the song is.
I have a song. I'll pass.
Amen, amen, amen. So, you know, if you need healing tonight, whatever you need, you can claim that precious blood that flowed from Calvary's tree and find it. 39 stripes he took for the healing of your body and mine and everybody else out there that's sick. Amen. We know that God is yet a healer. So we're going to sing one more little chorus and then see what we do after that. Amen. We love all of you. Thank you.
Thank you, my home.
To be awakened, hallelujah, because sometimes it's like we're asleep or we're in lethargy or whatever. But you know, I just have a quick little thought tonight. I'm not going to hold you very long because we've been going battling through a few things. But you know, I really want to tell the Lord thank you. I had two grandsons last week that both of them were in an accident and both of them totaled the vehicle they were in. But God spared them. One did it on Tuesday last week, and the other one did it on Wednesday the day after. So God is wonderful, and I thank God both of them walked away with no problems. The vehicles were totaled, but thank God my grandsons are still alive. And you can replace a car, you know, so I just thank God because God was with them. You know, I don't know about you, but I really firmly believe that Psalms 91 is vitally important. And I believe that every one of you, when you get up of a day, before you start your day, you ought to read Psalms 91 and decree it over your household and over your family, over your children, your grandchildren, over their lives, that the Lord would keep you and keep you in all your ways. Amen. So, you know, I just want to encourage you to read it. I believe that Psalms 91 is a shield for us. It's a protection for us against COVID and against everything that's going on out there. So, you know, we just posture ourselves in the Word of God, and God's Word will work. You know, tonight I'd like to ask you a question. Who is Jesus to you? Matthew 16 and 15, the Lord asked his disciples, he said, "Who do you say that I am?" And, you know, you might say, "Well, Pastor Edna, why is that even important?" Because your answer, on your answer to that question hangs your salvation. If he doesn't mean anything to you, then you're not going to serve him. You're not going to do what's right by him. You know, another reason is that what Christ can do for you depends on some degree to your faith in him and whether you believe in him or not. Amen. So, you know, he wants to forgive us. He wants to heal us. He wants to deliver us. He wants to set us free, and that's the truth. But, you know, we got to believe he can. We got to believe that he will. We got to believe that he shall. Amen. Matthew 9:28 says, "And when he was coming to the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus saith unto them, Believe ye that I am able to do this? They said unto him, Yea, Lord." So, you know, the key tonight is, do you believe that God is able? Do you believe Psalms 91 will work for you? You know, if you don't believe it, then it's really not going to do a whole lot for you. But personally, I believe that the Word of God is forever settled, and I believe that that Word works. I really do. I believe the Bible says it doesn't return void, and I believe that. You know, you really got to ask yourself tonight, do I really believe that God is able to keep me? Do I really believe that God is able to heal me? Do I really believe that he's going to make a way for me? Do I really believe that he can take this situation and bring glory out of it? Do you really believe tonight? Do you really believe? Who do you say Jesus is? Or is he somebody you just run to here and there? Or is he a friend that sticks closer than a brother? Is he the lover of your soul? Is he the one that you count on? Is he the one you depend on? Who is Jesus to you tonight? That's the question. You know, after 430 years of bitter bondage, the God of Israel manifested himself. A fire appeared on Mount Horeb to an ex-prince of Egypt, and that ex-prince's name was Moses. Exodus 3:14, and God said unto Moses, I am that I am. Hallelujah. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am, have sent me unto you. So God said to him, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And when God outlined his plan to deliver Israel, Moses asked God's name. God said, tell them I am, has sent me to you. Hallelujah. And you need to understand that it's important that you get it settled in your own heart. Hallelujah. Who Jesus is to you. Glory to God. He's not just a Band-Aid fix. He's not a Santa Claus. Hallelujah. But he's a friend that sticks closer to than a brother. Hallelujah. You know, God said to Moses, tell them I am has sent you. That divine name is translated Lord and is used over 7,000 times. Hallelujah. In the Old Testament alone. It's from the Hebrew verb hava, to live, and means God is not a God of the past who was, nor is he a God of just the future who will be, but God is eternal. So he's living outside of time, and he's living in the past, present, and future simultaneously. He is the great I am. I wish somebody could say on there tonight, he is the great I am to you. Hallelujah. I wish somebody could say amen, preacher. I can tell you that he is the God that I put my trust in. He is the God that has never abandoned me nor forsaken me. And he is the one that I believe will always be. Jesus himself declared that he was himself the I am. He is. John 8:56 through 59. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. Then they took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Jesus was saying, when he spoke to Moses, even further back than that, glory to God, hallelujah, that he was the God of Abraham. He said, before Abraham was, I am. Glory to God. So he was in the beginning. The writer says he was Alpha and Omega. He's the beginning and the end. Hallelujah. So tonight, I want to talk a few minutes about the things that he says, I am the bread of life. Another I am of Jesus occurred on a huge hill by the Sea of Galilee. Hallelujah. A massive crowd had gathered, and there was no convenience store. There was no Burger King. There was no McDonald's to get a Happy Meal. And there was a boy that volunteered to give his lunch, 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Jesus took it. He broke it. He blessed it. And then he gave it and fed 5,000 men, plus women and children. And they had 12 baskets left over. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Just as the Father sent me, I live because of the Father. So the one who feeds on me will live forever. So the one that partakes of Jesus, that that true living bread of life. John 6:35, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. So I want to tell you tonight, taste and see that the Lord is good. Hallelujah. You know, eating of that bread is a wonderful thing. Sadhu Sundar Singh was distributing gospels in the central province of India, and he came to some non-Christians on a train and offered a man a copy of John's gospel. The man took it, tore it in pieces in anger, and threw the pieces out of the window. And that seemed the end, but it so happened in the providence of God, there was a man anxiously seeking for truth, walking along the railroad tracks that very day. He picked up, as he walked along, a little bit of paper and looked at it. In his own language, he read, the bread of life. Hallelujah. He didn't know what it meant, but he inquired among his friends. And one of them said, I can tell you, it is out of that Christian book. You must not read it or you will be defiled. The man said to himself, I want to read the book that contains that beautiful phrase. He bought a copy of the New Testament and read John 6:35, where Jesus said, I am the bread of life. And as he read, light flooded into his heart. He believed on Jesus Christ and he became a preacher of the gospel. That little bit of paper became the bread of life to him. The one guy didn't want it. But he tore it up and threw it away as though it had no significance. But I'm here to tell you, God, hallelujah, is sovereign. And down the railroad track, he knew there was a man walking that was seeking truth. And he made sure that he was able to get a hold of it. He is indeed the bread of life. Another thing he says, I'm the light of the world. Glory, John 8:12 says, then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world, and he that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Aren't you glad for his light shining in your life? Hallelujah. Genesis 1:3 records that the very first act of God's creation was to say, let there be light. Before this, there had been only darkness and chaos. Then there were two opposites. He called one light the day, and he called the darkness, he called it night. This is the prophetic beginning of a great divergence, separation. Each opposite had its leadership, its moral position, its spiritual center, and its followers. In the spiritual realm, there is warfare between the angels of light and the angels of darkness. And on earth, the children of light are in contention with the children of disobedience. 1 John states that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The process of photosynthesis is how sunshine is turned into nutrient energy. Same as spiritual, as we behold his face, as Mary at the feet of Jesus. Don't you understand? As you behold him, you become more like him. Hallelujah. He said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And I come to tell somebody, Jesus is the only way. You know, we've all heard the politically correct talking points. Any religion that says their faith is superior to others is guilty of spiritual racism. All religions serve the same God. All people are basically good and going to heaven. But all of that is not true. All religions claim theirs alone is right, nor do they serve the same God. Buddhists don't even claim there is a God. Hindus claim that everything is God. Muslims serve an austere God, and Christians serve a triune God. All the world's religion except Christianity are do-it-yourself stuff. The adherents have to be good enough to earn their salvation. That's why they can never tell you for a surety that they're going to heaven, because they never know if they've done enough good works. But salvation is a done deal, beloved. Glory to God. Christianity alone is based on grace, not works. It teaches that God reached down to us because we were unable, incapable of reaching up to him. What was Jesus' last words as he hung on the cross? He said, it is finished. Through Jesus' death and resurrection, love's redeeming work was done. With all the world's religion, their adherents still had to do something. With Christianity, the work is already done. Jesus paid the price for my salvation, for your salvation, and opened a way to God. John 14:6 says, Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. So there is no other Savior, no other Redeemer. Only Jesus paid the price for humanity's sin. Only through him may we be saved and gain access to God the Father. I tell you, that's worth praising him for. He said, I am the door. So, you know, this is similar to the last one, but with an important difference. There was only one door into the Old Testament temple. There was no other access. There was only one door into Noah's Ark. Unless you entered by the door, you were drowned by the floodwaters. Amen. John 10:7 says, then said Jesus unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and he will go in and out and find pasture. You know, shepherds in Syria, there was a tourist in Syria that observed with interest how a shepherd drove all the sheep into a sheepfold one evening. The fold was an enclosing wall with only one opening. At that opening, he noticed that there was neither door nor gate, and he remarked to the shepherd, can't wild animals get in there? No, answered the shepherd, because I am the door. When the sheep are in for the night, I lie down across that doorway. No sheep can get out except over my body, and no wolf or thief can get in except over me. I'm glad, yes I am, that Jesus is the door protecting us and keeping watch over us day and night. What a wonderful good shepherd. Another thing he says, I am the good shepherd. The shepherd's psalm, all of us can appreciate this scripture because of David. Psalm 23 says, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. Leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. You know, David was grateful, and so are we. The Lord is our shepherd. He's watching over us. Aren't you glad he watches over you? And he's carefully protecting and providing for our needs. We couldn't have a better shepherd than God himself. Jesus is our shepherd. You know, Jesus adds to this picture the incredible sacrifice that he was willing to make. He said, John 10:11, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep. Isn't that what he did for us? Just as earthly shepherds hazarded their lives for their sheep, the more did the chief shepherd. Jesus loved us so much that he was willing to give up his life so that we might be saved. John 15 says, greater love has no one than this, than he lay down his life for his friends. Look what Jesus has done for you. Jesus was willing to become the man of sorrows and suffer and die on the cross to atone for our sins. John 10:27 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hands. Another thing he says, I am the resurrection and the life. So you know the story of Lazarus, and you know that everybody says Jesus was 4 days late. You know, they tried to tell him, you know, by now he stinks, and you know, there ain't no, he's already decomposed. There ain't no need to be looking into this situation. But John 11:25 says, Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life, and he that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Jesus has power not only over heaven and earth, but over the underworld, the afterlife. After his crucifixion, Jesus' body was placed in a tomb, but on the third day, he triumphed over death. That same resurrection power that was exerted to raise up Jesus will also be what brings all the believers out of the grave. You know, shepherds have found that if a mother ewe dies, another ewe who lost her lamb will not nurse or accept the orphan lamb, but will kick and butt at it. But shepherds have learned a way to get the bereaved ewe to accept an orphan lamb. They skin the lamb that died and place its woolly cape on the orphan lamb. When the mother ewe smells the cape of her old own dead lamb placed on the orphan lamb, she will allow the substitute lamb to nurse. How similar this is with us and God. When we put on Christ, God sees on us the blood of his son and accepts us as his own sons and daughters. Jesus makes us acceptable. Jesus asks his disciples, "Well, what about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Is Jesus just a good example or a great example, a great teacher or a great prophet? Or would you say with Thomas, when the resurrected Christ, he said, "My Lord and my God." Some of you need the great shepherd. Others need light on their lives. Some are spiritually hungry and you might need the bread of life. And all I want to say to you, he's available to you tonight. He knows exactly what you need. John 15:5 says, "I am the vine, and ye are the branches. And he that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." So we bless you tonight in the name of the Lord. Father, I thank you for those that have watched and those that are faithful to come every week. Lord, only you know their needs tonight. And I know there are many concerns across North Carolina and across our nation. Father, we need your grace. We need your mercy. We need you to intervene in these things that are not right. God, I ask you tonight to help us to know you as the great I am. Help us to know you in a way that we've never known you before. Father, if there's one that's listening to me that don't know you, God, I ask you to touch that heart and life and bring them to the knowledge of you as their Savior. Father, we thank you that you've made provision for us that we can be accepted in the Beloved. We thank you, Lord, that our identity is in you and it's not in these other things. But, Lord, you have put your finger of love on our hearts and you have changed us from the inside out. And for that, we say thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we know you as our healer. We know you as our burden bearer. And we know you to be a way maker. Lord, for those tonight that are struggling, many have lost jobs and many are wondering what are they going to do. Many are concerned. It's the Christmas season, Lord, and what are they going to do? But Father, I thank you tonight that you are a God of all supply. And I ask you to bring peace to troubled hearts. God, make a way tonight where there seemeth to be no way. Turn things around. Heal those that are suffering tonight with COVID. God, I pray for Mike McAllister's daddy, Lord. God, he's got double pneumonia in both lungs, and he's dealing with COVID. Father God, I thank you that breathing comes easy tonight. And I thank you that you bring up that stuff out of his lungs and that he's able to breathe and function. Lord, you be his portion. Lord, nobody can go in the room, but you can. They can't keep you out. Not only for Mr. McAllister, Lord, but for others tonight. Oh, God, for those tonight, the Lord, that are in the hospital beds, for whatever reason that they're there, we ask you, Lord, dispatch your angels to walk the halls of the hospitals. Go in from room to room and touch, heal and deliver. Bring them out, God. Bring them out. Enough have died from this COVID. Enough lives have been lost. God, we ask you to turn it around and bring victory in this situation. Father, we thank you tonight for all the many benefits that you have provided for us. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Father, tonight we bless you and we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. Thank you, Lord, that your mercies are new every morning. Thank you, Father God, for hearing our cry. Thank you, Lord, for turning our lives around. Thank you, Father, for making a way for your people. And God, we thank you that the blood covers us and that has made us acceptable to you. And we ask you, Lord, to bless your people through the week. God, we thank you for all things in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Thank you for being with us tonight. We thank you, Lord, for just thank you for always just showing up. And we ask you, Lord Jesus, those that the Lord would be your comfort and your strength. Have a wonderful week. And prayerfully, we'll be in church this Sunday at Solid Rock. And we just thank you for all of you that have been praying. We've had 4 weeks with not being able to be in the sanctuary. But we're believing the Lord that this week we're going to be able to go back in. Amen. And if the Lord says not yet, we're going to listen. Amen. We're going to be wise because as a shepherd, I want to protect the sheep. And we love you all. God bless you. And